Bibles, I would encourage you to open them up to Genesis chapter 4. Genesis chapter 4 is where we're going to start. It's not where we're going to end. We're going to be, just to give you fair warning, I guess, we're going to be all over the scriptures. We're going to be in several places and reading some kind of sort of longish chunks of scripture this morning. But we're going to be in Genesis 4 to begin with. And we are going to continue our series. Next week will be the last week in this series of our six big questions, which we got from asking people door to door and online what they thought were the most important questions that people could ask. And so we are doing that again today. And the question that we're going to be wrestling with is, why is there so much conflict? Right? So you turn on the news, you go online, read articles, you look out your front door sometimes, and boom, there it is. People in conflict with one another. Why can't we all just get along? As one person said at one point in history, I'm sure. We do seem to have trouble with this, do we not? We find ways to divide. We find ways to separate, to push each other away, hold each other at arm's length, and to get mad at each other and sometimes exchange angry words or even physical violence. There's quite a bit of that. And it doesn't seem to be letting up anytime soon, does it? And it ranges from the personal and small all the way up to the just global levels of conflict. You can see it all over the place. And it's over all kinds of different issues. It's over issues of race. It's over issues of morality. It's over, just kind of pick a topic, pretty much, and you will find something that people are willing to divide over and to fight over. And so we begin by asking the question, and I think the question actually probably gets answered very quickly. It's the aftermath of the question that really deserves our attention. It's the aftermath of the question that really deserves our attention. So this is a really interesting or a difficult question to deal with, because the one who answers must always of necessity indict himself. The one who answers the question must always indict himself. Now, what do I mean by that? The answer is, we are all to blame. Every last one of us. At some point in your life, you've been involved in conflict, yes? Has there ever been a time, and you might, I'm interested to see the kind of the answer to this one. Has there ever been a time where you have felt like you were at least in part to blame for the conflict? Yes.
Hand shoots up back there.
Yeah, absolutely. At some point, every one of us can be implicated. Every one of us comes to this moment where if we're being truly, fully, honestly introspective, we will look inside and say, I messed that one up. That was my fault. I can't. Have you ever had a moment where you said something and like the instant it was out of your mouth, you're like, no, come back to me. Don't go out there. Don't look at me. No. You have this thing inside you like, I just cannot believe those words escaped my mouth. Why did I say that? Why did I just let that one go into the open, set it free like a bird? Why did I do that? Or you did something. You performed an action that was hurtful to another human being. And you're like, I can't, why do I always find myself doing this? It's because there's something wrong with us. It's because deep down, intrinsically, far in the roots of who we are as human beings, we are people in conflict. The reason there is so much conflict in the world is because we're human beings. And we seek to fight. We find ways to divide. We find ways to conflict. sometimes, and this is the uncomfortable confession, sometimes we're just jerks. Sometimes we're just jerks. We wake up in a bad mood, or something doesn't go our way, and everybody around us is going to feel it. We know what this is like. We're all familiar with this. We've all experienced this. The problem, the cause of the conflict in the world is us. It is us. There's something about us that sometimes just itches for a fight. We want to be right. We want to be the one who is admired. And if we feel slighted in any way, God help the other person. Right? We're chuckling right now. We're laughing because we know that this is true. We don't need a rational, philosophical explanation. We just know it. That's why this question is actually very easy to answer. Why is there so much? We know why there's so much conflict in the world. Because we're people. And that's what people do. We find ways to hurt. We find ways to mess with other people. We find ways to make ourselves feel superior. We find ways to push people away. We find things to divide over. On purpose. And this is where we are. We are the problem. We very simply are the problem. The Bible would explain it this way. You have a problem and it's called sin. You are born with it. You are born broken and bent away from God, and born broken and bent away from other people. We long for relationship. We long to be loved. And yet, we sometimes go out of our way to make that difficult. What is up with that? And sometimes the best thing is not to simply say, well, that's because of this and that and the other. Sometimes it's just to look at the ways in which that works out. So if you have your Bibles, Genesis chapter 4, we're going to read verses 1 through 16. Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. I told you there was going to be a couple of longer things here. Genesis chapter 4, verse 1. Now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. And again she bore his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a worker of the ground. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground. And Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock, and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering, but for Cain and his offering he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his face fell. The Lord said to Cain, why are you angry, and why has your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must rule over it. Now notice the next thing that happens from that point. Cain spoke to Abel his brother, and when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel, your brother? He said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? And the Lord said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. And now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it shall no longer yield to you its strength. You shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth. Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, you have driven me today away from the ground, and from your face I shall be hidden. I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. Then the Lord said to him, not so. If anyone kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord put a mark on him, lest anyone who found him should attack him. Then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. So here we have one of the earliest narratives or stories or historical pictures of conflict that is available to us. And it's between two people who really ought to be close with one another, brothers. It's between brothers. And how is this pictured? How does this thing play out for us? We have these two brothers, and they work sort of one works in the field, one works with agriculture, and the other works with animals. And they, in due time, it says, bring to the Lord, bring to God a sacrifice from the fruit of the things that they have been producing. Now, there's all sorts of theological stuff that we could talk about here that we're not going to have time to get into, but the point is that we're going to focus on today is one of the sacrifices was accepted, Abel's, and one of the sacrifices was not regarded, Cain's. And what was the outcome of that? Before Cain goes off and does the thing with Abel, Cain and God have this conversation, which is it's a short sort of snippet, but it's absolutely fascinating, and it's very important for understanding what's going on. Cain is upset. It says his face has fallen, which means he's downcast. He's not looking anybody in the eye, and he's not looking to God. He's introspective. He's inside. He's doing kind of a pity party, and God says to Cain, "Cain, why is your face falling? What's going on, Cain?" And then he says this. He says, "If you do well, will you not be accepted?" Because there's an implication here that Cain should have known better. Cain knew what he was doing. Cain knows in bringing what he brings that it is not what God has required. Cain knows this. And yet, he still gets furious. Now, he can't argue with God on this. So what does he do? He goes and he finds the next person in line to externalize his hate toward. And who's that? His brother. So God tells Cain, look, this is your fault, not mine. And it's not your brother's fault. You're the problem, Cain. Who's the problem in the conflict? The person who begins the conflict is in this point. Right? Abel didn't do anything to him. Abel was doing his relationship to God. Cain was doing his relationship to God and doing it wrongly. And he knows he's doing it wrongly. And so then the conflict comes about. The culmination of hatred, the anger, bears its fruit. Cain slaughters his brother. God, if it's blood you want, I'll give it to you. And he kills his brother. And then there's this fascinating exchange again between Cain and God, where Cain is approached by God, and God says, whoa, what's going on? Where's your brother? And of course, God knows where his brother is, but he's giving Cain a chance to fess up. He's giving Cain an opportunity to come clean. And what does Cain do? What is his reaction? No, I'm not my brother's keeper. He gets snarky with God. And then God says to Cain, this is not okay. You've killed your brother. His blood cries out to me from the ground. The word cry is a word that is an anguished call for justice. Sa'ak. Your brother's blood, sa'ak, it cries out from the ground. It cries out for justice. This is what the people of Israel do in Egypt. When God says, I have heard the cry of my people, it's the same word. It's people who have been oppressed, who are requiring justice. idea of conflict. If somebody does conflict to you, it will grow exponentially. It will not simply stay between you and this person, but it will grow. If somebody kills you, you will be avenged seven times. Seven times. Now, we go a little bit further in the text. Genesis chapter 4, verses 17 through 19, and then 23 through 24. Starting in verse 17. Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bore Enoch. When he built a city, he called the name of the city after the name of his son, Enoch. To Enoch was born Irad, and Irad the father of Mehujael. And Mehujael fathered Methusael, and Methusael fathered Lamech. And Lamech took two wives. The name of the one was Adah, the name of the other Zillah. And then jump down to verse 23 and 24. Lamech said to his wives, Adah and Zillah, hear my voice. You wives of Lamech, listen to what I say. I have killed a man for wounding me, a young man for striking me. If Cain's revenge is sevenfold, then Lamech's is 77-fold. Okay? Seven was the number that if somebody had gone after Cain and killed Cain, God said, I'll avenge you seven times. Lamech takes it upon himself to say, if that's what it was for Cain, then me, so many generations removed, oh, it's going to be exponentially larger. It's going to be, now there's kind of a discrepancy here, because you can declare 77 times, or some translations will say 70 times 7, which is, somebody math whiz, tell me, 490. Hold on to 490. But the idea here is that when conflict occurs, we are first and foremost the people who are at fault, or anybody who's involved in the conflict. Usually, we bring it on ourselves. Secondly, conflict never stays in a very small, localized setting. It always grows exponentially. Look through the text. With Cain, seven times. With Lamech, 70 times seven, or 77 times. It just kind of keeps on getting bigger and expanding and growing and getting more and more out of control, does it not? This is what conflict does. This is what conflict does. It grows. Let me give you a little illustration. How many of you like to watch movies or television shows, stuff like that? Ladies, how many of you like romantic movies? A couple of you? Be honest. Men, how many of you like action movies? Okay? How many Die Hard movies are there now? Like six or seven of them? It's ridiculous. How many, take a franchised action movie and there's more and they get bigger and they get crazier and they get more explosive. How many sequels to romantic movies do you find? You don't. You don't. Why? Because conflict. What was that?
Because they're boring.
Because they're boring.
Oh, I love you, Doug. Be careful what you say.
Because conflict naturally grows. Conflict naturally grows where relationship seeks to resolve conflict. This is something we inherently know in our culture. Conflict grows. It gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Go through the book of Judges and read Samson's story. And it's a one-upmanship back and forth between Samson and his enemies. Well, now that you've done this, I'm going to do this. Well, now that you've done this, we're going to, and it goes back and forth and grows until economies are destroyed and whole peoples are slaughtered. Because conflict grows exponentially, it gets larger and larger and larger and larger and larger, and it doesn't ever want to stop. These numbers crop up again, but interestingly with a slightly different meaning. If you have your Bible, let's go to Leviticus chapter 25. Everybody's favorite book of the Bible. Leviticus 25.
the Lord. For 6 years you shall plow, you shall sow your field, and for 6 years you shall prune your vineyard and gather in its fruits. But in the seventh, that's the word seven, but in the seventh year there shall be a Sabbath of solemn rest for the land, a Sabbath to the Lord. You shall not sow your field or prune your vineyard. You shall not reap what grows of itself in your harvest, or gather the grapes of your undressed vine. It shall be a year of solemn rest for the land. Seven, and rest. The Sabbath of the land shall provide food for you, for yourself, and for your male and female slaves, for your hired workers and the sojourner who lives with you, and for your cattle and for your wild animals that are in your land. All its yield shall be your food. You shall count 7 weeks of years, 7 times 7 years, so that the time of the 7 weeks of years shall give you 49 years. Then you shall sound the loud trumpet on the 10th day of the 7th month. On the Day of Atonement, you shall sound the trumpet throughout all your land. You shall consecrate the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout the land to all its inhabitants. It shall be a jubilee for you, when each of you shall return to his property and each of you shall return to his clan. The 50th year shall be a jubilee for you. In it you shall neither sow nor reap nor what grows of itself, nor gather the grapes from the undressed vines, for it is a jubilee. It shall be holy to you. You may eat the produce of the field. In this year of jubilee, each of you shall return to his property. So we have this seven thing cropping up again, but this time it's about something different. The Lord seems to be counteracting this idea of revenge with a seven by talking about things like freedom, restoration, and forgiveness with a seven. Do you see this? You catching this? What is going on with God? What is he doing? What is he saying with these numbers? Is this just some sort of weird, arbitrary, well, now you have to do this, and you have to do it this way, and you have to jump through this hoop, and you have to kind of accomplish this, and you have to... No, he does everything purposefully. He does it purposefully. What is the point of the Jubilee? When Jesus shows up years and years and years and years later, and he goes into the synagogue to teach, and he's handed the scroll of Isaiah, and he opens it up and he reads, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, liberty for the captives, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That is Jubilee language, liberty language, forgiveness language. With this idea of the Jubilee, it is an idea of rest. It's an idea of rest. What's fascinating is one of the primary reasons that Israel gets sent into exile for disobeying the covenant, for breaking covenant with God, one of the reasons that God gives is that they fail to keep the sabbatical year of the land. They fail to keep the sabbatical year. This thing of rest and freedom and restoration and forgiveness, they chuck that. They set that aside and say no thanks to God. And God says, as per the conditions of the covenant that I made with you, and go check them out in Deuteronomy chapter 28 if you want, he will send them into exile. A foreign nation will come and take them captive. He says, I said I would do this. I promised you this is what would happen. But he also makes another promise. The other promise that he makes is that this won't be the way forever. You won't always be in exile. You won't always be in and under oppression. I'm going to do something else for you to bring you back to myself. But they go into exile. Nations like Babylon and Persia and Greece, right after one after another, Rome, one after another, they come and they beat down and they oppress God's people and they take them into exile and into under foreign rule. Because they
presenting my plea before the Lord my God for the holy hill of my God. While I was speaking in prayer, the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the first, came to me in a swift flight at the time of the evening sacrifice. He made me understand, speaking with me and saying, O Daniel, I have now come out to give you insight and understanding. At the beginning of your pleas for mercy, a word went out, and I have come to tell it to you, for you are greatly loved. Therefore, consider the word and understand the vision. 70 weeks are decreed about your people and your holy city to finish the transgression, to put an end to sin, and to atone for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal both vision and prophet, and to anoint a most holy place. Now, right before this, Daniel has been studying the prophecies of another prophet named Jeremiah. And one of the things that he discovers is that the time, according to Jeremiah, or at least as he understands it, that Israel is going to be in exile is 70 years. So he begins praying because about at the 70-year period when this all happens. And so he begins praying, hey God, the 70 years, it seems to be up. Are we going to get to go home now? Are we out of captivity and exile now? And God sends an angel, and the angel says, Daniel, a decree has gone out, and it is, that your exile will not last 70 years, but 70 times 7. 70 times 7. Math whizzes, what is that again? 490. Lamech says, if Cain is avenged 7 times, then Lamech 70 times 7. And years and years and years later, Daniel is praying in exile and under oppression, and he says, it's time to go home now. And God says, you got a while yet. It's been 70 years, but the whole thing is about 490 years. A mega jubilee, celebrating the forgiveness of sins. And what's absolutely, utterly fascinating is that it's around the 490-year period that Jesus shows up. To atone for sin, to bring in everlasting righteousness. This conflict that you're experiencing is about to come to its ultimate end. And it will come at the hands of one who shows up 490 years after the exile began. And who shows up 490 years after the exile began? Jesus. Jesus said, and he says something really interesting too. Something utterly fascinating. Matthew chapter 18. Matthew 18, verses 21 and 22. I love this bit. So Peter comes up to Jesus. Verse 21, then Peter came up to him and said, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as 7 times? Thanks, Cain. Jesus said to him, I do not say to you 7 times, but 77 times, or some translations say 70 times 7. What do we see here? What is going on here with Jesus? Jesus uses jubilee language to describe his work, his kingdom, the thing that he's up to. He says, this is what is going on. Forgiveness of sins for Israel meant coming out of exile. When John the Baptist shows up and he says, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of sins, a good Israelite hears that as the time of the exile is coming to its conclusion. A good Israelite will hear the time of your exile is coming to its conclusion. But how does John the Baptist describe this Jesus? As somebody who simply forgives the sin of Israel? No, he says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away what? The sin of the world. Because it's not just Israel that's in exile. It's not just Israel that's chained to this everlasting, ongoing need for contributing to conflict. It's the whole of the world that has a problem. It's the whole of humanity that finds itself jumping into conflict. It's the whole of every one of us that seeks a way to fight another. That we look for excuses, that we look for conflict, that we have our radars up for opportunities to say, no, it ain't that way, it's my way. And this Jesus comes and Jesus says, no, not that way. But there's a new mega-sized jubilee that is on the scene now in and through the work of Jesus Christ. Something amazing is about to go down in and through Jesus Christ. And then he is killed as a sacrifice and atonement for all sin. There he comes, ready to forgive. Forgiveness is going to be one of the key ideas in understanding what it means to put an end to conflict. Because what happens? What have we all already discussed about how conflict goes on? It grows exponentially. Because when I hurt you, what is your gut reaction? To hurt me. Right?
Yep.
This is what we do. If somebody slights us, we look for a way to get even. Or even if we don't look for a way, kind of want it to happen. We hope bad things happen to other people who hurt us. But what does Jesus say when Peter approaches him? Lord, if my brother, Cain and Abel, if my brother sins against me, how many times should I forgive him? Up to 7 times? Oh, look at Peter. Peter, you're trying to be so smooth right now, aren't you? Forgive 7 times. It'll be great. Jesus will love that. And Jesus says, no, that's not enough. That's not enough. About 77 times or 70 times 7. What is that? Is he giving a, no, you actually have to forgive them 490 times. Is that what he's saying? No. It's, you just keep forgiving that dude. You just keep seeking ways to end that conflict. And what are some of Jesus' last words on the cross? Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. How many of us, beaten, bloody, torn, mocked, spat upon, kicked, riled, reviled,
questions for reflection. How does your heart respond to global conflicts, wars, atrocities? Do you long for anything when you see them? Turn on the news and you see people being beheaded by ISIS. Or you see armies marching in to nearly defenseless countries. What does that do? What does that tell you about the conflict that is in you? How have you noticed your own contributions to your most frustrating conflicts? And this may be an opportunity for you to explore your most frustrating conflicts a little bit deeper. Sometimes it takes us going, maybe I've contributed something here that is part of the problem. How will you live in received forgiveness and practice forgiveness to end conflict? Because sometimes, by the way, you have to receive forgiveness. Sometimes you have to say yes to forgiveness when it's offered. And don't just go, oh, it's nothing. Own that junk. Own that thing you did and say, yep, I did wrong. Thank you for forgiving me. But also, learn to practice forgiveness. Learn to look at people who frustrate the daylights out of you and say, I'm not holding that against you. I am not keeping account of this. I am clearing the books. I am letting this go. And today, I am forgiven. Let's pray. God, thank you for forgiving us. Thank you for doing all that it took to allow us entrance into relationship with you. Because, God, we know that you and us, we couldn't have relationship apart from what Jesus has done. We pray, God, that we take that forgiveness that has so graciously been shown to us, and we share it with others. Help us to be a forgiving people. We pray, God, that as we move forward from today, that we seek opportunities to practice the forgiveness that you have shown to us in and through Jesus. And help us to receive forgiveness from others when they show it to us. And to explore together what